Sun shall pierce the night. gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, oh.
Continue to worship as we give today. At Vima, there's multiple ways to give. Thank you so much for your generosity. We couldn't do this without you. Now, if you're new to Vima, we want to connect with you. All you have to do is text Vima to 97,000. Now we're going to jump into the Word. I'm so excited about the message that Pastor John is going to bring to us today. So get out your Bibles, take notes, dig in deep, and let's have church.
But we're in a brand new series called Marked. If you weren't here last week, we kind of opened it up with this thought of being marked by God. What does it look like? What does it sound like? One of the things I kind of jested at last week was, if we're marked by God, does that mean we have to wear all those Christian t-shirts? You know, like maybe you have a t-shirt that says King of the Jews, but it looks like the Mountain Dew logo. You know, so do I have to wear those to be marked? Do I have to wear those to be a follower of Christ? No, you don't. But you can get those at Mardell's right down the road if you like those. But do I have to do that? Like, what does it look like? Is there actual, like, look and sound and feel to people who call themselves a follower of Christ? And I believe so. And like last week we talked about, what does it mean culturally? You know, so if the world is cultural and things are shifting and changing, does that mean Christianity shifts and changes? Is it cultural? So if you haven't got a chance, if you weren't here last week, I'd really encourage you to go back and listen to that. Because it kind of just opens up this whole series. But today we're going to be talking about prayer. And it may seem like that's a really obvious conversation to talk about prayer when we're talking about a Christian and what a Christian looks like and a follower of Christ looks like. But I really think prayer, if I'm honest, is something that we really struggle with as a church, especially the Western church, the Western American church. I think prayer is something that we really struggle with. And I think it's one of the simplest things, it's one of the easiest things that we can do when it comes to being a follower of Christ, yet it's often one of the last things that we do as a follower of Christ. And so I kind of want to talk a little bit about that and talk about the problem of prayer. And the problem of prayer, I think I'm going to give you a couple different problems. The first one is this idea of deism. So why do we struggle with prayer? As people who maybe believe in God, and I'll just lump a lot of us, if you don't, that's okay, just go with this here. But those of us who believe in God, this idea of deism, that means we believe in God, means that God created the earth, and this is kind of the perspective of deism, that God created the earth, but he doesn't really meddle with it. Like that God's powerful, and that he created it, and that he spoke, and there was light, and you believe creation and all that. But after that, like God kind of steps back, and everything else that happens is just happenstance, or it's natural law, or it's circumstantial, or it's seasonal. Like God's not really interested in the details. And I think if we're honest, I think that's how a lot of us, especially the Western church, still approaches God. And I think the reason that we approach God this way is because the reality is most of us have our lives pretty well under control. You know, it's ironic because I just prayed for you if you felt like maybe your life was out of control. But if I took a poll and said, hey, how many of you guys feel like your life is out of your control? Like it's just spinning in chaos and you have no say in it whatsoever. Probably no one in the room would raise their hand. Most of us would say, no, I've got relative control. Like there's a lot of things I can speak into. There's a lot of things I can do. And I could, if I didn't like this, I could do this or I can make that change. And as Western American Christians, we're pretty self-sufficient. I mean, if one of you were to say, hey, I would really like one of those, man, I saw one of those 80-inch TVs at Sam's Club, and it's like this big, and I think it's twice the size of my fireplace, which means it's the perfect size, right? And if you really wanted one, even though it may be out of your reach and out of your grasp financially in the moment, the reality is that almost everyone in this room, if they buckled down for a few weeks or a few months, they could probably go buy it. They could probably, if we just lived without a few Chick-fil-A's, and even though I don't think that really costs me, it's kind of free, right? It's chicken church. It's God's church. It's God's chicken. So it's like tithing, right, when we go to Chick-fil-A? So it comes back to us. No, it doesn't. But if we cut out some fast food or Starbucks or whatever, like most of us could probably find like a $500. And 80-inch TVs now are like $500, by the way. It's crazy. How many of you remember buying your first flat-screen TV for like $2,000, $3,000? And it was like this big, and it weighed like 80 pounds. And it wasn't very good. It was plasma, and it like heated up your house. You didn't have to run your heater during the winter. I still have one of those. It just keeps ticking. I don't know the way they made it. You know, but like now they're cheap. Like so the reality is though, all of us, if there's something that we wanted, most of us could find a way through a little extra work or a side hustle or a little cutting here to get what we want. So what that does to our mindset and what that does to our spirituality is it makes us feel like we've got a certain sense of control. That life is kind of mine. And this idea of deism is like, God created everything, but now I'm in control. And I think this hurts our approach to prayer because we kind of look at God like he's just far distant person, but I'm the one that's right here handling my today, now, the decisions, the consequences, everything that kind of falls on myself. And maybe we've never said that out loud. And as I'm saying this, maybe you're like, I've never said that, but now that I think about it, you know, I struggle with this. I mean, I think this is a common Christian, Western American struggle to feel like, what can I do? I got to keep control. I got to maintain. In fact, me and my wife are talking about this when it comes to school. Like, you know, what's school going to do? What's it going to look like this next semester? We can go to school for 2 weeks and get sent home for 2 weeks. Or how's this all going to look? Homeschool? Like, what are we doing? And like, there's this whole idea. But the real struggle that we had in our decision was not just, are kids going to be safe or teachers going to be safe? It was like, are we going to have any control at all over the next 9 months of our lives? Because the last 6, 7, 8, 9, the longest summer ever from March until right now, we've had almost no control. So we're making decisions right now based off of the things that we feel like we can control. And so that affects how we talk to God, how we view God. Maybe another problem you might have with prayer is disappointment. What do I mean by disappointment? I mean prayers that you've prayed that weren't answered. Maybe you say, John, I've prayed before, and I've asked God to do some miraculous things, some big things, and here I sit, and they haven't been done. And so maybe we feel disappointed that the things that we've asked for, the things that we've petitioned God for, we didn't get an answer, or maybe the answer we got we didn't like, and so therefore we're disappointed. And I'll tell you this, just a quick little snippet here. God always answers a prayer, and it's this. We just maybe not like it. It's either a yes or a no or later. And I think a lot of times, every prayer is answered. Every single prayer is answered. But a lot of times, I feel like we're frustrated because most of maybe the prayers that we pray, the answer is later. And God has us wait and has us be patient. And in fact, it says, when we know when we get to heaven, everything's going to be made whole. Everything's going to be made perfect. So everything that we're praying and asking God for, we will get someday. And so every prayer that we pray is yes or no or later. But that could be disappointing because we got a need right now. We got something we want right now. Here's another one. Distrust. Distrust. So our perspective and how we pray and talk to God is skewed by maybe the relationship that we've had with another believer. Someone else that calls themselves, maybe it's a pastor, maybe it's your youth pastor back in the day, or a kids pastor, or a youth worker, maybe it's your parents, and someone that you are connected with or in relationship with, and they claim to have a relationship with God, and based off what you've seen, you don't want that, and so therefore it creates a distrust between you and God because you're not sure if he's answering their prayers or your prayers or how all that works, so we kind of sit in this leaning back stake out of distrust. Here's another one. Maybe another problem with prayer is distance. I don't know. I could probably ask this question and probably everyone would raise their hand, but I won't this morning. But have you ever felt like, and you just think about this, have you ever felt like your prayers just hit the ceiling? Have you ever prayed and maybe you gave God everything in your prayer? Like you just hit your knees and you're crying out and you're asking God to do something and you're crying out to him. And then when you stood up, you're like, you just didn't feel anything. It felt like it hit the ceiling. It felt like it just stopped. As it fell out of your mouth, it fell to the earth. And sometimes it feels like we're far away from God. But we know through God's word that God is actually present everywhere that we are. So I think for some of us, maybe the struggle is this, is that prayer doesn't feel real because God doesn't feel real. And so this distance that we feel when we pray, that doesn't feel real because we're not even sure God feels real. We're not really sure he actually is real and has a relationship with us and wants to talk to us. And we're just kind of trying it on. And because we're trying it on, we're kind of at a distance. If you've ever been in a relationship with someone you weren't quite sure, maybe you, like if anyone's ever done a blind date, you get this, like, and I did one and it was horrible. It was the worst thing in my life. But it creates all this anxiety and all this tension, and you're like, am I getting catfished? Do they actually look like the picture they showed me or my friend told me about or whatever? But you kind of like walk into it with these hesitations. And I think sometimes we'd kind of do that with God because of distrust or disappointment. And then what we do is because God doesn't feel real, it's hard for our prayers to feel real, and they just kind of hit the ceiling. But we know that through God's word that it says he's present, that God is with us. His name, in fact, is Emmanuel, God with us. Scripture tells us where a couple people are gathered that he's there in the midst of them. And the scripture tells us that he's omnipresent, that he's everywhere. And then, in fact, the scripture even tells us that when Jesus left, he says, I'm leaving you in better hands. I'm leaving you with the Holy Spirit who will dwell with you and dwell in you. So we know that through scripture that not only is God here, is he around in the general sense, he's actually right here. But so many times it feels like we're distant. And I wonder, is it because he's distant? Or is it because maybe we're distant from him? And so is it possible for the God of the universe to be right here and me to be somewhere else? I absolutely think so. And you know that because you've done that. Maybe you've been hanging out with a friend that was on the phone while you're telling a story and you're like, you got to the punchline, right? And you told this amazing story about this hilarious thing. You got to the punchline. They go, uh-huh. Yep. Yep. Uh-huh. And they're just not there. They're there, but they're not there. And I think sometimes that's why our prayers feel distant, is because we're there, but we're not there. We're not really with God. We're not really experiencing his presence. And then here's another thought for us. Maybe it's distress. And I say maybe this because maybe sometimes we just treat prayers like kind of like an oh no, like it's a Hail Mary when everything else is going bad. And so it's a problem with prayer because prayer is supposed to be this conversation with us and God. But we struggle with it because it's just a distress. And for some of us, this is what our prayer life looks like. Right here. This picture sums it up, right? And I've been there. Break glass in case of emergency. It's like pray in case of emergency. It's like, holy cow, God, everything's going wrong. I don't know what to do. Like I'm stuck in this situation, or I don't know where to go, or I don't know what to do, I don't know what to say. It feels like it doesn't matter what I say, that my destination is already determined. That maybe you feel trapped by something. And so you go and you throw up these Hail Mary break glass in case of emergency prayers. And people pray, and this is interesting. This is actually, I did a little bit of study on this, but people pray In fact, it was like the percentage was somewhere between 96 and 99.99% of people prayed in time of crisis. Like almost everyone in humanity at a time in dire crisis, all of a sudden, they come and they break the glass and they go, hey, God, 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 if you're real, if you're there, I desperately need your help. So what does that tell us? That's not just a desperation. What that tells us is that inside of each person is a drawing, is a connection to our Creator. That we know when we're in distress that there's something inside of us that says there's got to be someone that's willing to help me out. And so people call out to Him. They cry out to Him. And I love this. Chris Hodges says this. Pastor Chris Hodges says this. Pastor, our prayer needs to be our first response, not our last resort. And so I think, though, we just go, we hit that glass, and maybe that's why we have a problem with prayer. Like, we're talking about prayer, we're talking about talking with God, and maybe that the reason we struggle with it is because I don't have any relationships like that. And in fact, if I had a relationship like that, people would say it was abusive, right? If you only call someone when you want something from them, and what you want from them costs them a lot, I mean, we would all say that's an abusive relationship. Like, I never talk to you. I'm not invested. There's no back and forth. There's no trust. I just come and I knock on your door and I say, I need $10,000, the keys to your car, and your oldest born son. Don't ask me any questions. You know, like, if I just went and demanded all the best things of your life, what's going on? Tell me what's... But that's kind of how we treat our prayer to God. It's these, like, lofting up these Hail Marys. God, help me out. Dig me out of this. So prayer, I think for a lot of us, I think for a lot of us today, prayer is an unexplored land of vast possibility. I think prayer is an unexplored land of vast opportunity. I think prayer for a lot of us today in this room is an untapped resource of untold treasure. Because why? Because our prayers are here and there, and when we really understand the simplicity of prayer, I think that there's so many incredible things that God wants to do in us and through us and with us and wants to give us and wants to see us do and all these things. And so let's look at the simplicity of prayer. I talked about the negative side of it a little bit. So let's talk about the positive side, the simplicity of prayer. I think when it comes to prayer, prayer is very simple. You know, I think we complicate it because I think we have a struggle of recognizing that God, the creator of the universe, and all His wisdom and all His power and all His glory and grandness and perfection and holiness would actually want to hang out with me. I think that becomes a... So I think here's how we have to approach prayer. I think prayer becomes real when you are real. I think when we approach prayer, we got to approach it just as us, just as me. When I come before God, I can't try to be Steve. I can't try to be Wes. I can't try to be Daniel. I can't try to be Stephanie. I can't try to be anyone else in this room, a Jackie. When I come before God, I can't try to sound like you or talk like you or be you. I can't try to have your experiences or your wisdom or your knowledge or your grace. I just got to be me. In fact, Matthew 6, Jesus talks about this. Matthew 6, 7. It says, "And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words." So Jesus is, he's saying, like, here's what I want you to do. When you pray, just be you. You don't have to sound or look a certain way. So talk about being marked by Christ. Does that mean when you pray, you have to pray with a certain voice or a certain sound or a certain look? You know, too many of us think it sounds like this. And you guys, if you grew up in church, you probably heard some prayers like this. "Thou art magnificent Lord. I beseech thee to beckon to my call as I cry out from the tempest rivers of my weary and wayfarer soul. Do not forsake thy ears to the rumbling sounds of my voice in the vast deserts, for I cry out to thee in desperate need of thouest help." You know, have you guys heard something like that before? I even tried to do the pregnant pauses and hit the table a little bit, but it's not wooden. I need a wooden pulpit that makes a little more sound. And, you know, like, even the older preachers that I know, the older pastors I know, and I'm not trying to make fun of them, but even them, like, I've had dinner with some of them or I've seen them outside. They don't talk like that, you know? And so Jesus is saying, like, you don't have to, like, look or sound a certain way. In fact, your prayer, maybe it looks more like this, like, hey, God, it's John. I know you know it's me because you're God. You know, the last week's been really tough. You know, we're trying to make decisions with our kids and school and what to do there. And I know my wife's tired of hanging out with them. It's been the longest summer ever. And I know we need to do a vacation. And I know we got this church. And God, I need some help. We need to make some better decisions. And we need to like maybe find like a little bit of time to go do something. And but yet need to like invest. And this is a great season. And God, we just need wisdom. God, I need your grace. God, thank you for just listening this morning. Well, I just pray. God, you're so good that even in this moment, you would stop and listen to me. Even though I'm not perfect and I've made many mistakes and things I said I'm never going to do again, I've done. God, you're just so good, and I just thank you for that. You know, maybe your prayer sounds something like that, and like that's a genuine prayer for me just right now. Those are things that we're praying about, and like that's just real. And I think prayer for us becomes real when we're real with God. I think God desires for us. And I think the Lord's Prayer, and in fact, I gave you an outline of the Lord's Prayer on your notes today on the back of it. And if you don't know how to pray, Jesus says the disciples go to him. And I preached on this a few months ago in a sermon called Real Jesus Prayer. And so I'm not going to talk about the Lord's Prayer today, but go back and listen to it. But I gave everyone a guided prayer, and I gave it to you today. So if you don't know how to pray, the disciples asked Jesus how to. You know, like right now, one of the top Google searches is how to. Like if you just go to Google and type in how to, how many have ever done that? Like you can fix anything in your house. You never have to pay anyone to come to your house and fix anything again. Because someone posted a video telling you how to do it. You just have to have a little bit of common sense. And so, but you know, how to. And so like Jesus, the disciples asked Jesus, how do you pray? Jesus gives them an outline, the Lord's Prayer. So the Lord's Prayer is how to pray, but what do you pray? Like, what's the words that you use? Like, if that's the format, if that's the flow, and I gave that to you guys, what's the words? In Psalms, I think David gives us a great perspective on how we can talk to God. Psalms 18, David says this, God, how I love you, for you have done such great things for me. That's a great prayer, right? Psalms 48, how great is God, and how much should we praise him for his goodness? That sounds great. Psalms 55, listen to my prayer, God. Don't hide yourself when I cry. That's pretty real. David's getting real. Let's go to Psalms 88. David says this, God, I'm written off as a lost cause. I'm just another statistic, a hopeless case, abandoned and already dead, one more body in a stack of corpses. So how do you pray? David shows us that Jesus says, how do you pray? Gives us a format, but David shows us what we can pray, which is just the real, authentic version of who we are and what we're going through. Why? Because God is a real God who really wants to have a real relationship with us. And so if we're going to have a real relationship with a real God, then that means I'm going to have to approach him as really me. And you don't have to sound like me. You don't have to sound like Vima. You don't have to sound like your spouse. You don't have to sound like your friend that's a better Christian than you or reads the Bible more than you. Just when you pray, you can do it just like this. God, it's me. And so I think that's a fantastic point and thought for us today. In fact, I want to say it this way. Prayer is an invitation to a real conversation between you and the God of the universe. How cool is that? Prayer is an invitation to a real conversation between you and the God of the universe. So the series is called Marked, and it talked about being different than the rest. How is this different than other religions? I'll tell you, a lot of religions have prayers, and their prayers are repetitive, they're ritualistic, they're maybe even chants. And in fact, I can't think of any right now of other religions that believe that they actually can talk to and have a relationship with, a friendship with, a familiar relationship with their God. Christianity is different than the rest because we believe we have access to actually talk to and hear from the God of the universe. And prayer is our invitation. It's the mode at which we do that. And I love this. Acts 17, I'm going to kind of show a couple scriptures here. It says, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of the heaven and the earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. So God made everything. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. So God's powerful. He doesn't need our man-made constructs. And it says, rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. Verse 26, from one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and their boundaries of their lands. So God's in control. We can trust him. Verse 27, God did this so that we would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any of us. So the God of the universe who created the whole earth doesn't need our man-made constructs of worship and praise and these things. And we love coming, and God actually invites us to come into his presence together. And God commands us, says that we shouldn't forsake the gathering, but it's not the building. It's not the chairs. And if that's the case, this wouldn't be it, because we're renting this. There's all kinds of other stuff that happens in here. This is not a holy consecrated place. This is a theater. An opera happens in here, and opera can sometimes be risque, if you didn't know that. I've been told. I don't listen to opera, but I've been told. You know, so like, it's not just the building or the chairs. It's God's presence in us and with us, that he did this so that we would seek him and then perhaps reach out for him. And then this is what I love, that we get to find him. So God is a God who desires to have a relationship with us. And if we seek him, and if we pursue him, he wants to be found, and he is not far from any one of us. Let's keep going. Another scripture. Let's go to Proverbs. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known them to his covenant. Friendship. The word covenant here means secret, intimate. So it says right here, the friendship of the Lord. God desires, and we have access to be friends with God. Exodus 33 is talking about Moses. Inside the tent, the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, not as Moses, but as a man speaks to his friend. This is the type of relationship that God wants to have with us, kind of relationship that man can have with God of the universe. In fact, when Christ taught his disciples to pray, he unlocked the filial relationship with us. He talked about the guided prayer that's on there. It says, Our Father's opening statement. This was groundbreaking for Jesus to say that the disciples could do this. The disciples came to Jesus and said, teach us how to pray. And Jesus said, first words out of his mouth, our Father, not my Father. He'd been saying my Father. He'd been saying that I'm the Son of God. He'd been referencing God as his Father. But in this moment, Jesus, he puts the opportunity, the prayer, the conversation when you have with God. He says, it's not this lofty thing for just me, the Son of God, and God, the Father, and the Holy Spirit to only participate in. In fact, I'm inviting you right now, and you get to say, our Father. I mean, that's how cool God is that he invites us to have a relationship with him, to be his friend, to talk to him, to get to know him. And so I think for some of us, this statement may help us a little bit. Prayer is not merely a way to get things from God, but actually to get God himself. See, I think the reason sometimes we have problems with prayer is because we view God as like a vending machine up in heaven. And the 50 cents or 75 cents or the dollar I'm going to put into the vending machine is the three or four or five or six good things I did before I came and prayed. As I go, hey, I walk up to the vending machine, there's God, and there's all the things I want out of my life. And I go, do I have any change in my pocket? Have I done any? Have you ever heard the statement, you better have some change in your pocket before you go have a conflict with someone? It's better to have change in your pocket. What does that mean? It's better that you've invested into them. It's better that you serve them. It's better that they know you a little bit before you go and you withdraw from them. And so I think that's how we approach God sometimes. We approach him like he's a vending machine, and there he is. That's what we want, A5. That's what I need some more of, $10,000 right there, A5. I'm going to put my four good deeds in. I'm going to loft my prayer up to God. I'm going to wait for it to pop out. But prayer is not just a merely way to get things from God, but it's a way to get God himself. And so we want these things, but we don't recognize is that God is actually the author and the source and the creator and the founder of all of those things. And so it'd be like this. I give you another example. I asked my son this morning, I said, hey, if I had $100, would you want it? And he was like, he gave me a big thumbs up. He was in the back of the room back there when I was saying it. He's like, yes, Dad, I'm 13. I want $100. I could spend so much money on Fortnite. It's not even funny. I can have five new skins that don't actually, can't touch them. They're just on the, yeah. I hate Fortnite. It's a waste of money. And so I always try to convince my kids to go get something when they have money, birthday money. Let's go buy something. Like, let's hold something. I'm old fashioned, I guess. They all want digital things. Like, let's hold it. I want to see it. I want, even if it breaks in a month, like I want to hold it, you know? And so I said, hey, do you want $100? He said, yes. I said, or what if I had a machine that just printed $100 bills at your disposal? And he was like, oh, yeah, the machine. And I think that's sometimes where we get mistaken when we approach God and we just want something from him. Is we won't realize that it's not just that one thing that we need in that one moment, but that God is actually the source of all good things. And that if we pursue a relationship with him, that the benefactor for that is us. The benefactor for that is us in so many ways. And I'm not saying go to God if you want $1 million. He prints money for you. That's not what I'm saying. Don't get that. What I'm saying is that God is the source. Would you rather have something that can duplicate it or multiply it or created it or is the founder of it? Or would you rather just have a piece of it? That you only get to, would you rather have the crumbs from the master's table, or would you rather sit at the table and eat with the master? And that's the invitation we have with prayer, is that God is inviting us to sit at his table, to have communion with him, to have conversation with him, to be real with him, to share our hurts and our pains and our frustrations. And we know this, that God is not a God that doesn't know our hurts and pains and frustrations. Jesus says, I know that, I've been through that, I've experienced that. So he's not just sitting across the table going, well, that must stink. No, Jesus is right there with it going, I've been through it. I felt it on the cross. I took your sin. I took the sickness. I took the pain. Everything that you've gone through, I've gone through. And so you're not sitting there at a table having a conversation with a God that doesn't understand, because Jesus is sitting right there saying, I went through all of that. I know what you're going through. And yeah, let's talk about it. And in fact, I think I can help you. I may know a way out of this. I may be able to do something for you on your behalf to help you get through this situation or bring healing or restoration to you. And it's just an invitation to the table. I love what Timothy Keller says this. It's a great quote for us. It says, prayer is the reordering of our loves. So what prayer does, when we talk to God, I think we want God to bend to us. But what happens as we start having a relationship with him is that it actually starts to reshape our own hearts. If you struggle, and maybe you picked up God's word recently and you read something you're like, you don't necessarily agree with, or something you struggle with, you're like, oh, that's hard. I don't know if I could do that. I don't know if I could live up to that. Well, by having relationship and prayer and conversation with God, then what God is saying, what Timothy Keller here is saying, is what happens is we begin to reorder our loves. The things that we desire begin to shift inside of us as we talk to God. And let's just go on to jump to the next one here. Got to keep going. Pray first, pray often. Pray first, pray often. Luke 18 says this. One day, Jesus told his disciples a story to illustrate their need for constant prayer and to show them that they must keep praying until the answer comes. Pray first, pray often. Rejoice always and pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Pray often, pray first. James 5:13. If anyone is among you suffering, let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise, which is a musical, a melody version of prayers. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call out for the elders of the church and let them pray over him in anointing oil with him from the Lord. And the prayer of the faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Pray first, pray often. I want to bounce back to this right here. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. What this tells me right here, let's simplify this verse for you. Pain is an invitation for prayer. Heartache is an invitation for prayer. Abuse is an invitation for prayer. Brokenness is an invitation for prayer. This word suffering is not just suffering. In fact, the Greek word there is actually weary, which doesn't just mean tired. It actually means affected. It means affected by something. And so is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Maybe you're weary. Maybe you're weary mentally. Maybe it's emotional. Maybe it's physical. This is a much broader than just a physical suffering. So what James is saying here is that no matter what you're going through, pain is an invitation for us to approach God. But not only pain, is pain an invitation to approach God? I love this. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. This is a melodic prayer. So James says this, basically pray first and pray often. Pray in your pain and pray in your joy. Pray when it's good. Pray when life is great. Pray when you've got everything that you need. When you feel like you're self-sufficient, pray then. But then when you're all the way over here and it's like, I got to break the the glass because I need a Hail Mary. If God doesn't come through, I don't know what's going to happen here. Pray then too, and pray everywhere in between. Smith Wigglesworth, they were having a conversation with him years ago. He's a theologian, pastor, preacher. Someone asked him about prayer, and he goes, I don't pray that much. He goes, I just pray for 20 minutes. I just pray 20 minutes. That's all I can do. I just pray 20 minutes. And someone's like, well, hey, I can do that. And, you know, Smith Wigglesworth, that's all he prays is 20 minutes. He goes, but my key is I never go 20 minutes without prayer. And so this is idea that I'm just in this state of openness. It's like almost like my ringer is set on to hear from God. You know, it's like I think a lot of us, we approach God with our ringer turned to vibrate. And we're like, God, I'm ready for you. And maybe that's like the good place. Like, God, I'm ready for you. And if I feel it buzz, I'll try to get to you. But what Smith Wigglesworth was saying is that I got to pray first. I got to pray often. I've got to be open and ready to have a conversation with God. And it's incredible that we have the opportunity to do just that. Luke, I got one or two more points. And we just bounce through these. James 5:15. Prayer changes things. It starts with me. You can fill in the blank. I'm going to skip that one next time. Luke 11:9. And I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. Prayer changes things. What this tells you, I tell you, if you ask, it will be given to you. This is present tense. If you ask, then it will be given to you. This is a present tense scripture for us. So what that tells us is that prayer changes things. Is that when we pray, that there's things that can happen or things that can be given or things that we can receive from God if we pray. So I'm going to keep going here. I'm bouncing through this. Get to my last thought here, which is this. Prayer gives you access to God. Prayer gives you access to God, which has kind of been the theme of the day. You think about this. Jesus, the Son of God, we know he prayed. I want to tell you about a few times that he prayed. Jesus, before he went to choose his disciples, you know what he did? He prayed. Jesus, the disciples, there was only one time that the disciples said, how do we do this? And that's recorded in scriptures many times that Jesus taught them things, but this was like, how do we have this conversation with God? And Jesus taught them to pray. Jesus healed people through prayer. Jesus cast out demons through prayer. Jesus prayed when he was tired. He prayed when he was tempted. He prayed when he was troubled. He prayed when he had big decisions to make. Jesus prayed in the morning early. He prayed during the day, and he prayed at night. A couple times he prayed all night. Jesus prayed alone. Jesus prayed together with just a few close friends. Jesus prayed with a bigger group of friends, like a small group. And then Jesus prayed with multitudes, with the congregation, with hundreds, with thousands of people. Jesus even died praying. So how important is it for us to be marked by prayer? Jesus, who is God himself, the Son of God, found it necessary to be in communion with his Father. Even in the darkest, the hardest, the most painful moments of his life, the thing that Jesus chose to do was to pray, was to talk to God. He prayed first, and he prayed often. Even Jesus, the Son of God, prayed. Why did he pray? Because prayer gives you access to God. When Jesus was on the cross, he was praying because he needed God's power to work on his behalf. He needed to be full of God. He needed to be fully God. He had just taken on the sins of the world. He had just taken on our sickness, our pain, our frustration. And there he was on the cross, having taken on every bad thing that we needed. And he said, hey, God, I need you to stay with me. I need you to be in my corner. Why? Because prayer gives you access to God. We have that same access to God that Jesus had on the cross. We have the same access to God that Jesus had before he prayed and picked his 12 disciples. We have the same access to God that Jesus prayed before Jesus prayed and he was baptized and the Holy Spirit fell upon him and a dove came upon him. We have the same access to God that Jesus, when Jesus prayed before he went into temptation and was able to defeat temptation, able to defeat everything that Satan pulled out in front of him. There was no addiction. There was no thing, no bondage that Jesus was bound by. He didn't choose to fall into any sinful patterns. And he did that because he prayed. And we have the access, that same access to God, the limitless, the powerful, the beautiful, the faithful, the loving, the unmatched, the undefeated, the glorious, the majestic, the one true God who was and is to come, the creator of the universe, the author of it all, the great physician, the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, Almighty God, Elohim, we have the same access to God that Jesus had. So prayer gives us access to God, and God is powerful. He's the source of it all. So why wouldn't we just, hey, God, it's John. I know you know it's me because I just did this a minute ago, and you know me. But here I am with some of my friends, and I'm asking for you to feel real to them right now in this moment, God. I'm asking for you to feel accessible to them. God, no matter what we may have done, no matter what we may have come from, no matter what our former beliefs may have been, God, right now I know that your presence is here. God, I know that you are here. God, I know that you desire to talk with each of us, to spend time with each of us, to know each of us. And so, God, right now I pray that everyone in this room would recognize that you are here and that you are real and that you really want to talk to them. God, thank you so much that you are not a lofty God who sits up on his hierarchical throne looking down in chastisement or condemnation or judgment towards us, but that you're a gracious God who sent Jesus to this earth to make a way so that we can have open communication with you. Jesus, thank you for what you did on the cross that opened up heaven towards us. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you're here and that you continue to speak to us and move in us and that you're in our lives and present in us. And God, we're thankful that you're just a part of all of this and that you chose to love us and send your son. If you're in the room today and say, John, I don't feel like I can talk to God. I don't feel like I have access to God because I don't feel like I really know him. I want to pray for you if that's you. If you say, John, I don't really know God, but I want to know God. I heard what you said about prayer, and I want to have that kind of conversation with God. If that's you, I just want to pray for you. Just raise your hand. Say, John, I just want to open communication between me and God. It's not there now, and I want to open it up. If that's you, just every head bowed, every eye closed, if you don't mind. Just if you say, John, I want to open communication between me and God, just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. So a couple of people, yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. Maybe you're in the room and say, I know God. It's been a while since I've talked to him. You say, John, I want to talk to him. I want to talk to him. I want to talk to him. I want to know him. I don't want to just read a book and believe it because it makes me feel better about if I die. But I want to like have a relationship. If that's you, that's my hand. I'm up in the air right here. I said, I don't want to be distant from God. I want to be present with God. If you say, John, that's you, me, I want a live prayer life. I want my prayer life to be alive. If that's you, just raise your hand all across this room. It should be probably a lot of us here. Say, John, I want my prayer life to be activated. I want to have a real relationship with God. I want to be able to talk to him. Here's what I want to do. I want to pray for us just real quick here, but then I'm going to give you a challenge after that. So let me pray. God, I pray right now for everyone that raised their hand, whether they said, I want to start talking to you more, or that maybe you were just being real and saying it's been a while, God. God, I pray right now in this moment, God, that we would just be able to talk to you. In fact, I'm just going to let Matt play for a second. I want to just let you just in the quietness and the stillness of this room, maybe some babies making noise, and that's totally okay. It doesn't bother me. If it bothers you, just close your eyes and tone it out. I want to give you an opportunity just to talk to God for just a second. Just, hey, God, it's me. Just talk with God just a second. God, we love you. Thank you for being accessible to us. You're so good. You're such a good God. Thank you. Thank you, Father, for wanting to be in relationship with someone like me. Not perfect, far from it. Yet you still want to know me. You still want to talk to me. And you still want to help me. You still want to love me. You still want to see me live my best life. And for that, I just say thank you, God. Thank you for leading me, for guiding me. Thank you for caring for me. Thank you for your unconditional love that's there even when I walk away for a few days at a time and come back when I'm in need. God, thank you that you're not a frustrated God who's easily ticked off or frustrated by my lack of or my empathy or my mistakes. God, you're a gracious God who's full of love and mercy, and your arms are always open. And for that, I just say thank you. You're such a good God. In Jesus' name, amen.